Audio, I'm number two.
It's the Pickleball Effect podcast. We're episode 33. I'm Braydon.
And I'm Kyle.
This is a big one, Kyle. The NDA is lifted.
Officially?
Officially. Well, when this releases.
When this releases, okay.
We're breaking NDA at this very moment.
Don't tell them that.
But when this releases, we'll be NDA free. The bounds will be loosed.
I was technically never under the NDA.
You were like posting stuff in Chris's Discord, just like what your favorites were, not really talking anything about it, and people were like, you're gonna get Braydon in trouble.
But I don't think legally I could get you in trouble. I don't know. In that, were you not allowed to let people use the paddles?
They never said anything. Okay. Because I was
we're
handing them around.
Got it.
I wanted everyone's opinion. But we're gonna start with this topic. But before we get into this, I need to just tell everyone how ashamed I am of them. Because I only got three book recs.
Three?
Three. There was like 3,500, 4,000 people that listened or watched.
Well.
Three book recs. Oh, you got it. Hello, Pickleball Mindset.
For you. Brought you a gift.
Do you have one too?
No, I'll just read it when you're done. I'm reading a book. Okay. I'm in the middle of a book right now. So I'm like, when Braydon's done, I'll just take it back and read it. But gift
for you. Thank you. I appreciate that.
They still left me on read. I tried another avenue of messaging them. Still nothing. So we'll still read your book, guys.
Pickleball Mindset. All right. Well, I'll read that. I'll give you the cliff notes.
Okay.
We'll talk about that later. Well, sweet. Thank you, man. But yeah. Our listener viewership, they don't like books, I guess.
No, they must be audiobooks or they just watch cartoons.
Probably cartoons, because they listen to audiobooks, then they would have recommended something.
I guess that's true.
Okay. All right, dude. We're getting into the paddles. So let's talk about just the tech real quick. And then we'll just dive into the implications of it. Cause I think if there's ever been a paddle that's changing the game of pickleball, the way it's played, this is going to be the one.
Absolutely.
So you and I got together a couple of days ago. We went and chopped up some of the old Gen 2 models to compare them to the Gen 3. So we'll pop up a picture, but this is just to show you that we did cut these in half. And the top one here is the original. So you can see some foam on the edge. This is the like perimeter foam injection that we see all over the place,
yep.
Right? So it was kind of interesting to see how like thin this was.
Absolutely.
Because these Perseus models are known for being a little less forgiving. I think that's why they probably don't use as much foam as other paddles, but it also makes it lighter. Anyways, so you can see the foam there, but with the Gen 3, it has that same perimeter foam injection.
More of it.
Yep. And then there's another layer.
Yep.
So this is what they're calling their propulsion core. Propulsion core. Yeah. What a tough word.
Propulsion core.
Propulsion. Say that three times fast.
No.
Propulsion core. That's really hard. Anyways, it's got this another layer here. So you essentially have a layer of foam that's extended about an inch towards the core. And then so the polymer core isn't, you know, there's kind of less of it because there's more foam on the sides.
Yep.
And it's attached to the core and essentially acts as like a trampoline. So I don't have a full paddle on me, but if we had a full paddle, it goes down to almost like midway through the neck is where that like second layer of foam stops, and then the outer layer
went all the way through the handle.
Yep. So that's the main tech they're introducing here, and yeah, like we said before, kind of gives it this like trampoline effect. And so there's a couple things really interesting about this. One, the power is huge. Right.
Huge, and it's very squishy.
Oh yeah.
More so once you cut it, but if you around the perimeter, if you squish that second layer of foam, is actually extremely squishy.
Yeah, it's even when you have you can feel the squish with the paddle intact, but it's more so with it cut in half there. But yeah. So okay. So we drilled these paddles last week. You've hit them before. Power level. Where would you put these on like the power spectrum of all the powers or all the paddles you've played?
That I've played? It's up there with like the Vice, like EVA foam style paddles. Like it's up there.
It's big.
And like we talked, like it's almost exponential. Like what you put into it, you get, it multiplies how much you're getting out of it.
Yeah, that was one of my observations that we talked about that I thought was really interesting. So like if I take another paddle and like if I swing twice as hard, you're going to get like twice the amount of power. But with this, it's, the power feels more like exponential. If I swing twice as hard, I'm going to get like three times the power.
I would agree.
And so the bigger hitter you are, the more you're going to get out of this. So like you hit bigger than me and you can get way more power out of it than I can. Like I'm still getting more than I can with other paddles, but not as much as you. And so like this technology like super benefits those who can already hit hard.
With topspin, you got to keep the ball in. That's the thing. So I think definitely geared towards the more advanced player that hits with spin to keep it in, because you, if you're hitting flat balls, they're going to just pound the back wall.
Yeah, you have to be selective with the power. Yeah, if you hit flat, then you don't want to unleash the power unless you have an overhead or a volley. Exactly. And so, yeah, so the power is like, it's just different with these.
I like it.
That exponential, and it's changing the game, whether we like it or not. It's going to get faster. It's happening. And so, how do you think this changes the game? And because I feel like this is going to make people more aggressive, it's going to make, it's going to change some dynamics, maybe a little bit of strategy. Like, does everybody need one?
No, I don't think so. I think everybody's going to buy one because it's new and it is very cool tech and it plays great, but I think there's going to be people that are not of the level that can utilize it correctly. And we're going to see people at the park that shouldn't have a paddle like this just absolutely launching balls at people's faces unintentionally.
Yeah, that park can be scary. So like when I was at the Yoli event, we walk into the facility, everyone's getting the paddles for the first time. I step onto the court with three others, and like literally the very first shot, we're just like warming up. We dinked a couple. He steps back. His first like attempt to hit it hard pegged me. Like it was just,
you just weren't ready for it.
It was just this, I wasn't ready for it. It was just kind of erratic, just this huge, just went for it.
Okay.
And I was like, oh my gosh. And it drilled me. So I wasn't ready for it. And like it's power I hadn't seen before, but like it is a little nerve wracking in the hands of somebody who doesn't know how to utilize it correctly. Because yep. I do think people are going to be, could be like just spraying stuff.
Absolutely.
And it could be a little bit scary.
No, and we've talked about this. Like as you go up in rating, people's shot selection is more calculated, a little more logical, lower levels, a little more erratic. So exactly, you're going to see people are just going to be speeding balls up left and right that are just, you're just not expecting. So eyewear.
Yeah, you're going to want some eyewear with these. And yeah, like I'm not necessarily scared of people who could manage it and use it right.
No.
It's just those that may not be skilled enough to manage it where I'm.
I think so. I think that's what we're going to see. Did you see the video PPA posted of Leia just ripping one? Anna Bright blocked it, no problem, but everybody was like freaking out at how hard she hit that drive.
Oh, no, I missed that.
Okay, you'll have to go look. She absolutely annihilates a drive, and Anna Bright resets it, no problem, but the ball is it's smoking. Cooking.
Yeah, if you're not Annalie, maybe you don't reset that so easy. Yeah, people are taking notice of how much harder they hit on tour. People on tour are wearing glasses now.
A lot more.
And yeah, so like I feel like the big question for these of whether or not like you should get it is, can you manage the power?
100%.
So I guess that's one question. And then the second question is like, or I guess going along with that is, okay, can you manage it? And then you need to kind of like analyze, okay, the extra like points and benefits I get from this power. So I can hit drives harder, I'm going to get weaker returns. Or excuse me, I can hit serves harder, get weaker returns. I can hit drives, put more pressure, potentially get easier thirds. I can put away balls easier. Okay, those are all benefits. Then like the drawbacks, right, are like the resets, the dinking. Yep. Attacking stuff below the net is a little trickier because it's easier to fly the ball. It's easier to fly counters out. So like there's give and take, but I feel like if you can manage it, it's awesome.
It is crazy. And I don't say that about paddles very often. So
yeah, it's pretty unique. Like when you go, when I go and play other paddles after playing this, like they all feel sort of dead.
Everything feels soft.
Yeah. Yeah, everything feels a little soft, a little more dead, and it's fascinating.
But now that this NDA is lifted, do we see other companies go to a similar core?
I don't know. So there's patent pending stuff involved. Okay. And so I don't know, but I do think this power is potentially achievable in other ways. And people are going to be looking for ways to find the power. And I don't know how they're going to do it. But I think everyone's going to be trying to find this power, whether it's good or not for the game, which is like a question that like I have, and that this is being brought up now, is like, is this much power good for the game? Do we want the game to go this direction? Does it make it more fun for TV? Does it make it more fun for rec? What are your thoughts there?
Well, I kind of agree. I think it was it Colin that said basically, do you want to see longer rallies or do you want to see shorter rallies? More power, shorter points. Less power, slower ball, longer points. So it's kind of like, what do we want to see?
What do you want to see?
I'm a fan of basically where it's at now. I don't need any shorter than it is. But then I don't totally agree with it because I almost feel like singles points have gotten longer, I feel like. Like some of these guys are putting down some long points with some crazy shots and athleticism. But I mean, it's tough. I mean, I like it because power's fun.
Yeah, if you play a power game and like if you're attacking all the time, you don't rely on soft shots to win points, like no question, go for this because this is only going to make that better for you.
Yep. Accentuate that strength.
Mm-hmm. But if you are more of an all court style player, like to play, you know, a mix between attacking and defending, like this could be questionable. It can help, but it can also hurt you in some ways. Like for me, like I said before, like I'm not a huge power hitter, and I noticed the biggest difference, like the extra power wasn't winning me more points on drives. Like I wasn't winning more points. Yeah, I got some softer, you know, responses off drives and could set up easier thirds. But like the driving wasn't big for me. It was just counters and putaways that made the biggest difference for my game. And like when you first play with it, you're like, oh, you want to play fast, you want to play hard. And you have to like take a step back and be like, hey, just play normal.
Play your game.
Yeah. And just access the power when you need it.
Yep.
But on the control side, like it does it. I'm not going to pretend like these are easy to control because they're not.
No, like counters, resets from transition, very little like user input to get that ball to go back over. And I'm going to like, there's going to be a lot of pop-ups from people thinking they need to kind of put some into it when this really does propel off the face, which makes resetting easier. You just have to know how to use it.
Yeah. I mean, that's debatable. It kind of depends on your technique and how you do things, but it can make it easier.
Absolutely.
Or harder.
You're true.
Depending on things. But yeah. And then the best description I heard somebody say about it when they were testing it was, it feels like you're playing with the wind behind your back the whole time. And like, I was like, oh, that's
actually a very good description.
That describes it really well. Cause like, if you've ever played with the wind behind your back, like you have to take a little off serves, you have to take a little off drives. You just have to take a little bit off everything. And that's what it feels like with this. And then as you kind of get better with it, then you can kind of unleash it at the right moments. But a lot of the time you feel like you have to take a little off.
Absolutely.
And so it's like, okay, is the power even helpful if you have to take it off? Because like on drives and things, it's very easy to go long. It's very easy to go long on counters. But it is nice that, like you said, you can just tighten everything up. Like just you just have to meet the ball on counters. You just have to.
Less body movement.
Yeah, less is more.
Yeah, exactly. Less is more. That's great. That's a good description.
And so I definitely think a lot of people are going to really like this extra power.
Everybody's going to buy it.
It feels very, very lively. And it's the you're going to see a lot of comparisons to this to the Gearbox. I do think this is Gearbox level like power.
Yeah, I'm curious of your thoughts because I somebody asked me to compare it to the Gearbox. How do you feel it compares?
Yeah, so I think these pedals have two big advantages over the Gearbox. One, you have multiple shapes and thickness options. So you're going to have the Ben Johns Perseus model, which is the 5.5 inch handle and the elongated shape. The Magnus, which is Tyson's model, which is five inches or 5 1/4 shorter handle.
Definitely feels very short comparatively.
Mm-hmm. And then the longer shape. And then you have Collins and Anna Bright's, which is the standard shape with the 5 points. So you have more variety there, which I think is a big deal. And then the second one is these are just more forgiving.
Okay.
And so when I'm playing with these, when I do make a mistake, it's because I pop it up or I make an error that way. It's not because it wasn't forgiving enough, particularly on the 16s. The elongated versions of the 14s do have tighter sweet spots, but the 60 millimeters, like, I didn't feel like the forgiveness was an issue.
No, they were very forgiving.
It wasn't like a special feature, like, oh man, this is the most forgiving elongated shape, but it's good enough, right?
Massive sweet spot.
Yeah, but it's good enough. It's like those two things, I think, are big advantages it has over the Gearbox, although I did prefer the feel of the Gearbox over these. These do have kind of like a hollow, harder feel. It's kind of hard to describe. Like, how would you describe them?
Hollow's a good term for it. So you like the feel of the Gearbox better? Are we talking like at the net or in general?
Just in general. Okay. Just like the feel at impact is a little more muted, a little softer, just more pleasant. These definitely have a harsher feeling to them.
I would agree with that.
Particularly the 14s.
My biggest, when I asked, my biggest comparison or my biggest difference was at the net with the Gearbox for me in a hands battle. If somebody sped up at my chest, it was very hard for me to keep that ball in because I felt like it was so poppy. I felt like these were more forgiving in that, like if you hit one at my chest, felt like it was easier to reset it. Where the Gearbox, I felt like it was coming off the face like quick.
Yeah, the Gearbox, I'll have to look at the numbers. The Gearbox might be a little jumpier than these. And again, it comes to that point of like how much you put into it.
You know, it could be that too, because with the Gearbox, it's skinnier. Am I subconsciously just pushing a little more?
Might be, I don't know. Thinner? But they're pretty similar. But yeah, you're right. Like they're both very strong there on the counters. Which is like a huge highlight. I definitely notice points end quicker when things speed up. like especially on counters, like I kind of was just waiting for the counter versus speeding up just because counters, like just get it in the way and gone. Unless I'm playing Abe. Then it comes back still.
Yep.
But it's fascinating, it's man. Cool. I do think this is going to change things. And I know that every brand's going to try to reach this level because I do think these are going to be popular. They are pricey. They aren't doing discount codes off the gate, which is a bummer.
So 280 for everybody?
280 for everybody. Yeah, so I don't have a discount code for you guys to go there. If you are interested in these and you want to support the channel, I'll have links, everything in the description. If you purchase through the links, it'll give us a little kickback and help me pay Kyle so he stays around.
Yes. $5 an hour.
Yeah, that's it's going to go out though eventually. Once that color grading gets perfect, then
the color grading gets better, and then once Liquid Death gets back to me,
yeah, then I'll bump up your pay.
Yeah, deal.
But yeah, this is going to be really fun to get everyone's responses. Yeah, so these will be available for pre-order. The 16th is when we release this video, and then I think they'll start shipping like the week after.
Okay,
and then they'll start getting into their places.
But people will have them the 16th, then, right?
Like local, pro shops,
like some of the local places.
No, I don't think.
Okay.
I think the 23rd is like the launch for like retails, pro shops.
Got it.
In those places, unless they get them in earlier, I don't know. If I'm a pro shop and I get it on the 22nd, I'm gonna sell it on the 22nd.
Break street date.
The street date. Okay, yeah. So that's fascinating. Really excited to see what people think once these start getting to people's hands. It is gonna. It's just tough to say, like. Do you just hop on the train? Do you go figure it out? Like maybe you're not a big power paddle player. Do you just make the jump and go? Like if everything's
getting
hotter.
The newest tech, absolutely. I mean, and there's people out there just want whatever's the newest tech.
But I'm just saying, like because the game is going this direction, like you just have to follow suit.
I think so.
But then I look at people like Augie, and like he's playing with like a Vatic Pro V7 on tour, and like that's like. A super soft paddle, and he's kicking butt.
And he plays great. Yeah.
So, like, I don't think you have to have this.
No.
To win.
Not everybody's style fits this paddle. So.
But yeah, that's everyone's going to be looking to these. So, sticking with paddles, I finally got more information on the new Vatic Pros coming out.
Okay.
So they made that big splash last year. It's been over a year since they've released any like really big newer paddles. And so he sent me some more information. It's likely to be dropped in May. They are saying it's going to be another huge power paddle, but it's going to be built differently than these.
Okay.
And then I know Carbon has another their own kind of big power paddle that they're working on that is also built different from this brand, from JOOLA and from Vatic Pro. So it's kind of fun to see more varying tech. Like a year ago, it was just somebody put, you know, make a paddle that works, everyone else copies it. But now we're starting to see variations and we're starting to see more R&D efforts. We're starting to see technology unique to each brand, which I think is really cool.
So we're going to see a lot more patents and we're going to need to sharpen our saw blade.
Yeah, we're going to be cutting up a ton of paddles. We do. But next time, I want to figure out how to cut it like in half this way.
Okay.
I don't know what kind of cut you'd call that, but
we'll figure it out.
It'd be fun. Anyways, yeah, we're gonna get really good at cutting up paddles. we cut up so many paddles. I think it was about $1,000 worth of paddles.
I posted it in one of the Discords under the wasting money thread.
Oh, yeah. There's a whole thread dedicated to wasting money?
Correct.
That certainly belongs. I am pumped that there's more tech coming out. There's more variation. And I wonder if patents play a part in that.
I think they'll have to.
Or this. Just that the market is maturing and we're starting to see more like better relationships between brands and manufacturers than they're able to work together. So rather than the manufacturer just pushing new tech, like Kevlar, I think is a material that's just getting pushed by manufacturers. Like, hey, we figured out we can do Kevlar. Do you want to buy one? Whereas I feel like all these brands now are working hand in hand with the manufacturer to develop their own stuff. And it's,
that's exciting.
I think it's great. Lots of stuff coming out there. And then we talked about Head last time and how they had their thermo paddle coming out. So the price
is a little too late.
It's $220. They're charging $220 for this. I was a little bummed because all their other paddles are like $160, $150. And so I assumed that they were going to stick around that price.
But it's thermo.
But yeah, I just feel like it's too late in the ballgame to come out with the $220 thermo.
We won't know until we swing it, but the assumption is definitely too little too late.
So that was kind of a bummer to see, but maybe it's cool. Maybe that little grit raw carbon fiber combo is like exceptional spin. I don't know. We'll hopefully get those soon. You've been on like a rampage this week with paddles.
So I've been hitting some paddles and talking to some paddle manufacturers.
So I get a call this week. Kyle just rings me up. He's like, dude, I just got off the phone with the Babolat head of marketing for Pickleball. And I'm like, whoa, back up. You just are chatting with the marketing directors of all these companies now?
She watches this show.
So. It cracked me up when you called me, and then they sent me an email later asking if they could send me their new stuff. So got those on the way, and I feel like you're a little drunk on this new position here. Like, what else you got coming?
Well, I'm just trying to get. I need some paddles too, so we can kind of compare which paddles are what. Yes. And the Babolats are exciting because I mean Chris Hayworth, he just won gold at the U.S. Open. Like today, singles.
Dude, the U.S. Open happened this week.
Well, it's still going.
I didn't even know.
I know. That one always comes out of nowhere.
I feel like it was, at least I was on top of it last year.
But that's why Anna Lee and I think Catherine and them, I think that's why they weren't at the PBA because I think they're all at the U.S. Open.
That makes sense. So I think JW was at the U.S. Open.
I think so too, yep.
So because the PPA field was a little weaker.
But yeah, paddles, Babolat, talk to Standout. Who else did I
are you? Are you calling them? Or are they calling you? How's
mainly
this happening?
It's me calling them. I'm about 50-50.
What's your pitch?
I don't have a pitch. It's just
obviously it's working.
Hey, I'm Kyle, co-host of the Pickleball Effect podcast with Braydon. And got any paddles you want me to review? Basically,
call me if.
Here's my digits. I just slide into their DMs. If they call me, they call me. If they don't, they don't. Some leave me on red. That's fine.
But you're also doing like other stuff that's like not paddles. Like have you run into any
some
fun stuff?
Well, like this week I'm trying RTP Tennis sent me some socks and then like these heel pads that go below your insole. So when you're like, I'm not a small guy. So when you're doing like aggressive split steps, do you ever have like heel pain the next day ever?
Yes, my right heel.
Okay. So these go under your insole. They're pretty small, but they're like these little gel pads that are supposed to basically prevent that from happening, it'll take away your heel pain. I just got them yesterday, not tried them yet. Right. So
we'll get the report back later.
We'll get the report.
Anything else you got your eye on? Like,
I messaged the Dink Trainer people. They didn't message me back. Like the wrist keeps your wrist stiff thing.
Yeah,
they left me on red. That's fine. So
yeah, but lots of stuff coming out still. It's so many paddles. It's just bizarre. And then you brought up the Vulcan.
The new ball formula.
No, the paddle.
Oh, the paddle. They came out with a paddle. It's old technology, and it's 260.
I didn't look into it. Like, how old?
I don't even think it's thermoformed. I have to go double check. But, like, in the description I read, thermoformed was not in there. But yeah. 260? I mean, 280, innovative, brand new tech. I'm not paying 260 for a Vulcan.
No.
Sorry, Vulcan. I will try your new ball when the formula comes out, though.
So there's a new formula?
New formula for the ball. They told me they're a couple months from release.
They told you, like, you were talking to Vulcan about
this? Yes. Talking to Vulcan. Well, I asked. I was like, hey, can we get the new ball? I heard there's a new ball. They said it's a couple months. Then they'll send us some balls. So
the plan for this is to be the new ball for the tour. And this is kind of sparked by pros complaining about the current formulation.
Yep. The Vulcan points.
The Vulcan bounces. That's right.
The Vulcan bounce.
The Brasha Vulcan bounce. Yep. So they won. The players won. They're getting a new formula. And the goal of this new formula is to...
I would assume more consistent bounce. Probably get out of... Stay round longer. Not having to switch balls 2 points into a game.
You know, like, props to them, though, for going and making a new formulation. Oh, absolutely. I think that's cool because the way I imagine that whole thing happening with them, we got the deal. Like, we need a ball. And they just, like, bought a ball.
Millions of balls.
Millions of balls of, like, a just kind of like a catalog ball. And now they got the product out. They got feedback. Now they're taking the time to really make something nice. And that, like, props them. I think that's cool.
I like it. I hope the next ball's better.
Me too.
All right. Wild theory. Going back to the YOLAs.
Okay.
So there has been some people posting that Ben Johns, his paddle sounded different than everybody else's. And the theory is, and I guess this is commonplace in tennis, that he is using old tech but skinned like the new paddle. And apparently in tennis, this is very commonplace, mm-hmm. where they will repaint their rackets to look like the new racket, even though it's the old racket.
Do you think that's slimy or fine?
So I see it both ways. Obviously, you need to promote the new tech. But if he likes the older paddle better, I mean, I'm torn. Like, I'm torn on that.
It is kind of weird.
I can see it both ways. Like, yes, it's kind of like false advertising a little bit.
Yeah, I kind of feel like that. But there is obviously a precedent for it, like you said, in tennis. Like, it's not like this hasn't been done before. But yeah, it does feel kind of weird.
They were comparing it. So they were saying him and Fed were using the same Perseus, and they sounded completely different.
So, yeah.
So, bar delamination, to say it wasn't delaminated, they think that the old tech is skinned as the new paddle.
You know, I mean, obviously we don't know for certain, but I always felt like Ben's liked softer paddles. He's always played 16s. He hasn't always been big
on
power.
He's not a big power hungry guy, no.
Yeah, and so it wouldn't surprise me. But yeah, I don't know how I feel about that.
Like whether you approve or not?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm torn. I don't
know. Yeah, that's an interesting one.
I'd love to hear what you guys think. Is that slimy or is that, I mean, if it was commonplace in tennis, it's...
Or is it whatever?
Yeah, yeah. Is it whatever? That was a good
There was a lot of talk about that for Annalise paddles, but although I think she just uses...
That was the other way around. They thought that her paddle was way hotter than the production model.
But I don't think that's the case. I think she's using the production model.
Now?
No.
Okay.
Before, I don't know, but pretty sure she is now. Is that 12.7 millimeters pretty hot? All right, what else you got?
There was a bunch of new PPA signings. I say signings. I heard about a few of these offers. 3 years obligated to PPA, no outside tournaments, for your entry fees covered.
That's all they're covering?
Yeah.
Locked in?
Yeah.
PPA?
Worth
only?
It?
No, because if I'm at that level and that's all I can command, I'd rather keep playing for a year, do more APPs, get better, and then come back and say I'm worth more.
And then get the guaranteed money. That's kind of how I feel too. So there was a lot of signings. There was some big signings, but then there was smaller people that I think were more so just for optics of more signings.
Yeah, maybe you can get more sponsorships if you're a sponsored player.
Possibly.
Or like if you're a PPA sponsored player, then you can get more, you know, whether it's a paddle sponsor, clothing, whatever. Maybe
you can demand
more
a little more.
So yeah, I guess I can see that. But I do feel like betting, like if you're really doing it and you're going for it, you're training, And you're progressing, like give yourself another
year. Don't sell yourself short. That's how
I feel. Like it's gonna, people have gone from zero to hero in a year and like you could do it.
What else? We got big upsets again. Lots of upsets this tournament.
Yeah. There's
Kwang Dong took down Ben Johns.
Dude, what did you think about that? He looked good, didn't he?
I was trying his serve, like, because he plays full Western. Uh-huh. I was trying that out. Yeah, everything he hits just dips so hard.
Yeah, he smokes it.
So. But he ran into the buzzsaw when he got to Fed at the end.
That is so good, dude. But it wasn't just Ben. Who else did he beat?
He beat Vic. Who else did he beat?
Yeah, those were the two big ones?
Yeah, the big ones were him beating Ben and then Vic.
He's beat Ben twice now.
That is correct. Twice. Mary Brasha and Lacey lose to Samantha Parker.
The Thrive gal.
The Thrive gal, yep. So she made it to the finals.
In singles.
Got worked by Leia.
But she made it to the finals.
Big deal.
I've never actually seen her play.
She's got a very interesting, like, loopy swing. You'll have to go watch. She definitely plays different. She played well.
She's younger, right?
Yeah, younger, yep. And
The Thrive owner...
Go ahead.
He messaged me right when she got into the finals. He was so pumped.
Oh, I messaged him right when she got into the finals, too. I didn't get a response, though.
I'll make an intro. I'll make an intro.
Thanks.
You're going to be the communications manager now.
I should.
You're much better.
I'll be the PR guy.
Yeah, you're much better at talking people and negotiating than I am.
Another big upset. Donald Young takes down Connor Garnett.
Tell people who Donald Young is.
Well, he was a tennis player, lefty.
Not just any tennis player. Well, like,
was he top?
He was
a big deal, right?
He was top 100 for sure. I want to say like 60, 70. Like
okay, so really up solid. There. Lefty. He's got really strong. Like he hits the ball hard too.
I think he's like 33, 34 maybe.
That sounds right. Very athletic.
Yeah.
But last time we saw him, I feel like he couldn't hit the ball over the net very well. He's playing with a Proton. But he looked like a different beast. He looks like he's figuring it out.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really impressive. I did actually watch him beat Connor Garnett. And he looked great.
You know, that match was pretty good. I mean, that was a different different guy.
I want to go look at his, like, I don't know what you call it. His, like, I want to see, like, what his wingspan is, because he looks like he has really long arms. And I was like, that would be really nice to have at the net. Like, he's, like, 6 foot anyways, and he looks like he has long arms. I was like, that would...
He has some ground.
He has, like, a body that's, like, made for, like, racket sports.
He's definitely a beast. Then the last upset, I don't know if this is really an upset. This is kind of just some drama. Paris lost to Leia. And then afterwards, apparently, Paris tried to challenge the paddle.
Tried to? So it didn't?
No, no challenges.
You can't challenge paddles anymore?
Nope.
I forgot.
Yeah, we talked about this. That's right. Yeah, yeah. So she was over at the ref chirping, and a couple people that were there saying she was trying to challenge her paddle. But
I think she just has one of these new YOLA paddles, and she can hit hard.
If this passes, I mean, then it passes.
Yeah, that's something we didn't talk about is, okay, how are these legal? So because it has, like, this normal polymer core, that the deflection test is basically, like, just a rod that, like, pushes down on the face. So it's actually pushing down against, like, the plastic part.
And that's what I was going to ask you. So does it just push in one spot?
Yeah. Okay. It just pushes, like, in the sweet spot. And so this is almost like a way to almost kind of, like, bypass.
Well, that's what I was wondering, because if it pushed there, there's no way that would pass. Because that is, like, that is squishy. Like, that pushes down as much as a vise, like an EVA foam paddle.
Yeah, it pushes down in the center.
And it's stiff there.
Yeah, and it feels, you know, it's stiff, it's normal. And, like, I wonder if they're, like, it's pretty clever, really, if the deflection test is, like, you know, using that as the rule.
Yeah.
But when they switch to exit velocity, like, I don't know what they're going to do. Like, are they going to make this the baseline?
That's what I think I was going to say. If you go to exit velocity, I think it should be like, all right, whatever the hottest legal paddle is currently, deem that as the point. Because you can't just, like, this paddle's illegal. That's not cool.
Yeah, and it's YOLA, right? Yeah. Like,
no, and like they should be the kind of the measuring point.
Yeah, by the time the exit velocity test comes around, there's going to be, you know, how many thousands of these in the hands of people?
Tons, and everybody at the park, and that's like a whole deal too. Is like people would be like, "You go to an illegal paddle, like take the pro play out. If you go retroactively, like this is illegal." You get like fights at the park or people getting shanked here, you know.
That's not gonna be pretty. That's a good point though. I bet you're right. I bet this becomes the baseline. And even if this is a baseline, it gets still very hot.
Oh, absolutely. That's plenty of speed.
It's plenty of speed. This is definitely pushing it. And I personally don't think we need anything more than this.
I would agree with that.
There might be innovations on, you know, how they get to that speed. And when they do exit velocity, I wonder if they're going to allow like more foam in the core because the deflection doesn't matter as much.
If we go to exit velocity and they just like let you go wild with core material.
Yeah.
See, that'd be kind of fun. Because then you could probably change like some dwell time stuff. Like, you could change some other stuff that would alter. Because if it sits on your paddle longer, it throws you off.
Yeah. More deception. Yeah, that would be interesting. I never considered that till just now, but you're right. Like, yeah, if like they did like more of a diadem vice style where it does like, cause like these have that harder, harsh feel. Like the vice feels very soft and pleasant soft. And doesn't like the vibrations are very dampened and like, yeah, maybe make a variation of that. Then all of a sudden you can get this power with a more comfortable feel rather than trying to deal with the deflection challenges.
I'd be okay with that.
Yeah, me too. Actually, I think that'd be brilliant. And then
take notes.
Everyone would have to ditch these for the next $280 vice
like paddle. $333 foam selkirk.
Yes. Sorry, keep going. Tangent there.
That was a good one, though. There was also Lucy. She was on Discord talking a little bit about just like the tournament environment.
This is Lucy Kovalova?
Correct. She was in Discord talking a little bit about kind of just the current environment. And she was saying it's mixed doubles is not as fun anymore. Playing against these guys that have illegal paddles. They're not illegal, but I see what she's saying.
She's just talking about the hot paddles.
She's just talking about the hot paddles.
So she's not a fan of the big power.
She's not a fan of the big power.
Huh. What, like, she just said it's not as fun because she's...
She said it's just not fun being in front of a guy with an illegal paddle.
Oh, because that's a very common tactic, right? Like, the guy drives the ball at the girl, tries to look for a weaker response or a point. yeah, they're just seeing huge drives at them.
So we are seeing pros that obviously are adopting this, and then we're seeing pros that are not YOLA players that are like, we don't like it.
Yeah. If you're not a YOLA, then you're going to be complaining, right?
Yeah, because you don't have the heat.
Once everyone gets on the same playing field, do you think we'll still see comments like that?
That's a tough one. I think we'll see less once everybody else's paddles achieve that kind of hotness. But it does, I'm sure it does feel unfair that your paddle that you are playing with is not as poppy as the person in front of you. And you have no way to change that because you're a sponsored player.
Yeah. I feel like we've kind of heard grumblings of that from pros here and there, and this is just another one. But yeah, I imagine that would change once everyone's even again. And that's such a weird thing about the pro scene right now is usually equipment isn't different enough between all the brands where like certain players have more bigger advantage than others. Like in any sport, pretty much like equipment is just very personal, right?
Yep. Basically the brand you want to associate with, but you can acquire the same capability of equipment from each brand.
Yep. But with pickleball, it's different right now. With the tech evolving so fast, things changing so fast, like the paddle can give you an advantage.
Absolutely.
And like we see a lot of YOLAs in the semifinals and the quarters and in the finals. Like there's obviously a lot of YOLA players, but I don't know if that's correlated or not. But yeah, so I do feel like, yeah, the paddle you have now, because of the difference in tech between brands, can give you an advantage. And we saw that with spin too. Like when carbon fiber, raw carbon was getting big, like there was complaints about certain paddles having more spin or more this, more that.
Oh, I remember the shape of the ball changed drastically. Like that year, the year that carbon fiber became big, like just people's shot shape was so different.
Yeah.
It was much more like they were just diving drives where everything else was a little flatter. Like the Dave Weinbach, like when he was in his prime versus like now.
Yep. And then once everyone got on the same playing field of spin, it just,
yeah, then everybody stopped complaining.
Everyone stopped complaining. Mm-hmm. I wonder if it'll be the same.
Well, I think we'll see the same thing. One last thing she did say that was interesting. I asked what she thought about if everybody had to play with the same paddle, if the results would be the same.
Oh, I'm curious. Yeah, what she said.
She said she thinks Ben and Annalie would still win, but she thinks the rest of the results would be drastically different.
Oh, really? So she does think the paddles have that big of a difference. Like
maybe
she's making it to
She thinks other than the top of the top. Like she thinks like they're on another level. Everybody below, paddle tech is way more of a factor.
That's fascinating.
So, and I mean, she was a top pro for a long, I mean, she still is technically a top pro, but I mean, that's big coming from her.
Yeah, that's really interesting. It makes sense though. Like if you have everyone who's similar level and then they just have that little advantage with the paddle tech, they're gonna win more. Unless they're all the same, like she says.
Exactly. So I think that's really all I have as far as news and drama.
Yeah, we'll finish with one last segment called the in or out segment. So I got some questions here. I'm going to throw them out there, and we're just going to debate whether you're for it or against it. We've already talked about this one a bit, but is power good for the game? Are you in or out?
Oh, it's such a hard question. I think power is good for the game up to a certain point. That's a terrible. I do think we have to cap it at some point.
Yes.
And I think this could be the cap point.
Yeah, I almost feel like these are even maybe a bit too hot.
Okay.
In my opinion, I'm out on more power. It's got to be capped here at the very least. I would be okay if it came down a little bit because I really think it could cause some issues at the amateur area. Even like in our play, like, you know, crap happens off a counter and you can do some damage. Like you can get,
there's going to be some wild balls.
So I'm out. I definitely cap this. If I was in charge, I'd bring it down even maybe a little bit. Okay. In or out, paddle tech patents.
Shape, not so much.
Okay.
Core and like the inner workings, absolutely. I'm okay with that. The shape to me though is like we have such defined dimensions that we can even create that it's like I don't think there's that many shapes.
Yeah, I agree. I think paddle tech is very cool for the guts and the inner workings and different pieces of it, but shapes facing materials I don't think should be patented.
No.
I know people have, Pickleball Apes went after Kevlar because they were...
they wanted to patent the use of Kevlar? They wanted to
patent the use of Kevlar.
Oh, wow.
It was pending. I don't know where... I mean, patents take a long time. Maybe they're still trying to make it happen, but they're trying to make it happen there. 6-0 did try to... Or trying to patent
I think they got their shape.
Did they? I don't know if it was finalized, but yeah. Okay. That was a shape patent.
Valair is going for the patent for their wide body.
They're going for a shape, yeah. And shape being like the literal like head shape or design.
Yeah,
whether it's tapered or bigger.
Do we get to patent our handle shape next?
Yeah, this is, I'm the only one that could do 4.25 inches. Yeah, I agree. I think the certain dimensions, it doesn't make sense. Like, I think anyone, it should be fair game. But yeah, the guts, things that you helped develop that way, I'm pro patent that way. Like, if you developed it and you figured it out and it works, you should own it. Like, I think it should be yours. And I don't know how patents work in other sports. Are they big in other sports?
I don't know. I'd have to look into it.
I just thought of it. I want to look at, like, I want to see if tennis.
I'm sure there's a bunch of patents in all the sports, though.
I would think so. Some sort of aspect, something that can differentiate you. Patents are kind of weird how they work because you have to, I think technically in order for a patent to like work, it has to be like approved before you like release the product. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we've seen that in pickball.
No, I think you have a lot of people releasing stuff and like patent pending.
Yeah.
And it's just to like scare you away. Like, yeah. Is there like...
Is it legit?
I don't know. I'm not a lawyer.
Gearbox is big on patent stuff too. But yeah, everything's pending. I don't think I've seen like, oh, this is the actual patent.
Patent yet. Approved.
Patent approved. Yeah, I want to see some patent approved. Anyways, patents are funny, but I do think people... if they do develop it, they deserve it. They should keep it.
What do you guys think? Patents, good or bad for the sport? Leave a comment.
Then, okay, this one. Rally or traditional scoring?
There's another one where I see both sides. I think rally scoring, especially to 11, changes the game drastically.
It does. It changes the dynamics of how you play a little
bit.
At least
with
when to be aggressive, when to be defensive.
Exactly. I think to 21, like MLP, it's not as bad. But it still changes the game. Like your bit, like me going for big serves becomes a lot scarier with rally scoring.
Yes. And another thing I think rally has going for it is four events. So you can control the time, right? Like that was a big reason part of the reason MLP went for rally scoring is you can say, okay, this matchup is going to take this so much time. Yeah. It's good for TV, but it's also good for amateur events. So a lot of complaints for tournaments of saying, oh, I had to wait an hour and a half between, you know, my matches, and I hated that, and I was there all day. But if you have rally scoring, courts are going to open up quicker, things are going to flow nicer. There's a more predictable. You can just schedule the event better, and it'll run smoothly. And so I think rally definitely has a place there in events, and then in just open play, dude. Like parks are crammed.
I can see that too. Keeping the paddle line moving, especially like because we have some places that have four courts. I mean, we don't have these big 32-court outdoor facilities. If you have four courts and 100 people, I mean, you're getting like a game in an hour.
Yeah, it's horrible. And the rally would keep that moving.
That's true. Because
like, you can have a 25-minute game to 11 if it's, you know, you go to deuce at 11-11 and like, it's hard to come by points sometimes. And rally scoring, you know, it's what, 10 minutes every time.
Exactly. We used it last year in a tournament here, actually. They went to rally scoring. The NAMI tournament, the mental health tournament, they went to rally scoring because it was much more predictable when the matches were going to end, made scheduling much easier. It was easier on court monitors and everybody.
Yeah, court monitor, even us. Like, okay, we know we're going to be there from, you know, 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. And then you can plan your day around it rather than think, oh, I don't know if I'm going to be there all day or not. So but the only way for rally scoring to be adopted versus traditional, like it has to be like the rule.
It has to be, yeah. If it doesn't go in the handbook, there's no way you're going to convince Julie at the park to play rally.
No, Julie's not going to do it.
No.
But there's I do feel like.
Or Joe. I don't want to be sexist. Joe or Julie, they don't want to play rally scoring.
Thank you. Freaking Joe. So I'm pro rally, although I do enjoy playing traditional more. I think it's more fun.
I think more strategy.
Yeah. But if you had to say in or out for rally or traditional, what do you say?
I say in.
You're in? Especially if you do 2 out of 3. One game to 15 rally for like a tournament doesn't feel
no.
like enough. It'd have to be 2 out of 3.
I would agree.
I'd be mad if it was just one
game. I actually despise when you play one game just to period. 15. Yeah, just because everybody has a bad game. Like, if you beat me twice, you're better than me.
Yeah.
You beat me once, you might have got lucky.
100% got lucky.
Well, if you beat me and Braydon, you definitely got lucky.
But like, a lot of places do like the 2 out of 3 for the main draw and then back draw 150. I think
that's okay.
But yeah, the main draw, I definitely like the 2 out of 3 format. All right, last one, in or out, PPA serve rule. What do you think? Listening, if you don't know what this is, they changed the rule like a handful of tournaments ago where pros have to hold the ball out in front of them. Just drop
palm facing down, drop it, and it has to be like from below the hip.
Yeah, you have to hold it, and it's like it only can go so high.
The ball can't like go up.
Yeah, you can't release it up, you just have to drop it straight down. And this came because of complaints about illegal serves, people dropping the ball above their waist or
sidearm
type serves. Yep. But only a few people push the boundaries there. Yeah, what do you think? For or against it, or in?
I don't like it. I am a fan of the serve innovation. The spin serve is a little much, but I think you should be able to toss the ball up, and if you can follow the rules and hit it below your waist, go for it.
So how would you solve the problem of illegal serves then?
Refs growing a pair and calling the pros out that we know have very questionable serves.
I mean,
there's only a handful of pros that have like super questionable serves.
Yeah.
If the refs were just like calling them on it, it would stop.
Do you think that new rule really curbed the like power people are able to generate?
Nope, not at all. I think the pros that are going to generate power will always find a way to generate the power.
Deckel's still smoking it.
Yep, Deckel still smokes it. Tyson still smokes it. Guys that hit big serves are still going to hit big serves. No matter what rules you find and put in place, they will find a way to do it.
I am pro this rule because I know if I was a ref, it's just one less thing I have to worry about. And I don't have to worry about confrontation. I'm kind of anti-confrontation. I know there's going to be refs that are same personalities.
Can't be a ref be anti-confrontational.
Not every ref has the abilities of Kyle to just say what you want and be okay to fight about it.
Are they going to fight you?
I don't know, maybe.
Oh, all right.
I was at this one tournament. This is a, not tournament. It was tournament champions of PPA last year.
Okay.
So Alshon and Julian Arnold were playing on one of the outer courts, and Arnold was not happy about some calls, and he was really getting into the ref, and she just stoically stood there and just let him, you know, do his thing, and then they would go back and play.
So that's why you need me to be like the head ref, and I'll come over and take care of it if he's getting in front of the, the female ref's face.
You're a head ref guy. Anyways, I felt bad for her, but so I do like the rule, and like it's just one less thing they have to worry about. I don't feel like it's stopping them from ripping it. Those who are still ripping are still ripping. So I'm pro this rule. I think it's good.
Would you be pro going to the drop serve?
Like full time?
Because that was talk.
Oh.
Because that just makes it way easier on the ref. There's like no, because there's still like some like, did they propel the ball upwards? Was it above their hip a little bit? Like there's still some gray area there. If you go drop, there's no gray area whatsoever. You drop the ball, hit it however you want.
Yeah, I guess that would simplify it even more, but I don't know. It doesn't feel like I feel like it would kind of stupefy or dumbify the sport a little bit.
Doesn't it feel like you're almost playing like more of a kiddie game once you go drop serve?
Like I'd be embarrassed.
I apologize to you that use drop serves, but it feels less cool to do a drop serve.
Yeah, like all the pros doing drop serves, like I want to be a little embarrassed. But like, hey, check out the sport I love on TV.
It already like... Oh. Couldn't handle it.
That'd be tough. But no, I think it's a good rule.
Okay.
But there we go. That's everything we have. Let us know where you are on those questions. And if you get the YOLA,
let us know what you think.
Let us know what you think. It's happening. It's here. But I don't want you to feel like you have to buy this thing just because it's new. Make sure you think about it and read my review because I'm at like 2,000 words right now. When I finish, it'll probably be close to like 4,000 words.
Is it dropping once the NDA is lifting?
Yeah, so once the NDA is lifting, I'm dropping my written review. So
okay.
There was a bunch of like issues getting the production models out to the reviewers like in time for the 16th. So I actually don't have the production. I've been playing with the prototypes.
Oh, so you're going to base your review off what you get this week.
So I'm basing my written review off of... off of my experience with the prototypes. And then I'm going to go play with these production models for a week. And then I'm going to go rerun my power and my spin tests and just see if that's similar. The spin on these, or the grit on these, feels very rough. I'd be very surprised that the production models are.
Isn't a little less? I agree.
Yeah. These, this, I was,
well, here we go. Here's production last gen.
Yeah. Much rougher.
Way different.
I was skeptical if YOLA like selected some super gritty ones to give to everybody at this event, just
especially,
so they
especially
got
the reviewer, you super reviewers. Spinny. Yeah.
And so I ran the spin numbers on these, and they were huge, much bigger than anything I've done. And so I wanted to wait until the production to publish.
Do you have the StarNet tester?
I no.
Okay.
But
we know somebody has one. We should use his.
We should. That would be interesting. I do know somebody that tried it on these, and it did come over the limit by, I think they said 20%. Don't quote me on it, but it was over the limit.
Okay.
And so I did want to wait for the production model to do that and to shoot the videos. I wanted to have the production on there. And the written review, you can change. Like, okay, oh, the power, maybe it drops a little bit or something. I don't know. I can go update the written review, but like a video, you can't.
Once we're out there, we're out there. Anything we say is just stuck on the internet.
Yeah. But yeah, we'll see. And, the power was big, and like the more you played with them, I felt like they did get a little hotter kind of as they broke in a little bit. So like the BJ16 I played with the most, it kind of handed around the most, and it got the highest, results when I did my power test. And I wonder if it was just because it got used more.
Or does that foam get squishier as it breaks in?
Maybe. Like there could be something like that that makes the paddle even a little juicier over time. And anyway, so there's a few considerations I wanted to take in with these production models before I did my video review and potentially adjust my written. But the written review is will be published when these are available to purchase on the 16th.
Sweet.
There we go.
Share the show.
Later.